film went into production in New York City in 1979, though it was originally called Hot Lunch, a title which lasted only until our director, Adam Parker, saw that same title on a marquee of a porn house on 42nd Street. He changed the name of his feature to Fame. And in the original production script, the last scene of the film, the climax of the entire four-year journey to New York, read something like this. Interior high school auditorium today. In front of an audience of family, friends, and teachers, the senior class guests and saints in celebration of their graduation. The end. That was it. That was the only roadmap that all departments were given for months of pre-production and even after cameras started rolling. But how did you have a plan? Because he wanted to showcase all the many disciplines and talents of the student body, he wanted a song of size. And his model, day one, was a song called El Dorado that had been recorded in 1974 by a British symphonic choir called ELO, Electric Light Orchestra. And El Dorado was an ambitious track with a solo vocal, intricately stacked harmonies, lots of strings and processed sounds. And Alan Parker had his heart set on using it as the finale. But because that finale was not scheduled to be shot until the end of filming, which went on for 91 days, Michael Gore, who was serving as the film's music supervisor while at the same time submitting some of his own original compositions for possible inclusion in the film, figured there was a chance to change his mind. And Michael's reasoning went like this. Because in the plot of the film, the keyboardist character, Bruno, supposedly wrote the song Fame, which his cab driver father proudly blasted through speakers he mounted on the roof of his taxi in that now famous dance number in the street. Can't we imagine now that Bruno would have a hand in writing his own class's graduation ceremony? And to really sell it to Alan Parker, we want to be sure to tick off all those boxes. We need to provide screen opportunities for faithful works. Solos, a chorus, a rock band. We need a dance break at home. Why not? We throw in a gospel choir. So, as a starting point for a lyric, I began by asking myself, what literature would Bruno have been exposed to in the course of a four-year career? A line, or a title, or a phrase that might have stuck with him and provided a jumping-on point for the final creation of his high school career. So, I visited libraries and bookstores. I went through shelves of reference works and anthologies. I made lists of novelists and poets and essayists, both American and international. I wrote reams of unsuccessful stars, scrapped my ideas, and continued. Then, after almost 3 weeks of every day reading this assignment, I was taking a break to attend a friend's dinner party. And on my walk to his apartment, heading uptown on Holmes Avenue, in the middle of the crosswalk at 72nd Street, I suddenly remembered a line from Leaves of Grass, Walt Whitman's poetry collection from 1855. I sing the body in the gift. And there it was. Sing as in voice, body as in dance, electric as in synthesizers and keyboards that Bruno played for his audition at the top of the movie. Of course he'd remember that line. And suddenly all the weeks of prep and research and notebooks filled with unfinished sketches came rushing back. And by the time my friend answered his front door, while his dinner party was already underway, I said, please, I need a pen and a piece of paper. And with those in hand, I rushed into the bathroom, shut the door, sat on the floor, and using the toilet lid as a desk, I wrote in one fell swoop the first verse in its entirety, starting with I sing the body electric, and ending with and in time, we will all be stars. And Michael Gore, who up till then always had notes about every lyric I ever said in front of him, bless his heart, he sent this verse exactly as written. Well, within days, I finished the lyric. Michael days after Michael gave Alan Parker that yell, Alan then came Threet on set. Threet was the producer David Hutton, who had not only produced Alan's films Midnight Express and the musical Bugs and Malone, but was 1 year away from winning the Best Picture Oscar for producing Chariots of Fire, a film that also captured the Oscar for Best Score by Ben Gellers. So, David Putnam knew his way around music. And in the course of his day on the set, Alan Parker apprised David Putnam of the saga surrounding the finale of his film and how torn he was about the decision he faced. And then he pulled out one. Fast forward to the end of shooting that day. David joined Alan and the key members of the crew, including Michael Moore, in watching the previous day's dailies, which were some dance under the covered by three cameras. In other words, the dailies and the dance days went on for a very long time. And when they finally ended, and before the house lights came up, from the last row of the screening room where Alan and David Putnam were seated side by side, David sang in the dark, I sing the body electric, I celebrate the me yet to come. Well, by then the house lights were on, so everyone turned in time to see David Putnam turn to Alan Parker and say, use the fucking song. And that decided. So we went into the studio, we recorded the basic track of the 5 minute number, a number that would eventually and we had a rough mix ready in time for the last week of production, but the shooting of Not Electric took 5 long days of 3 cameras to film. And because Alan Parker banned his original sets, I wasn't present for any of them. I didn't see the number until I attended the film's premiere at the City Film Theater in New York in May 1980. To say that I butt-planked this America is